My lecture today or tonight is mainly geared to people who know the two writers that we are talking about. So tonight is a tribute to two great pillars of modern Israeli Hebrew literature, but they are also giants of international literature. And just recently, maybe some of the professors know, the New York Times came out with the 50 best memoirs in the past 50 years. And I was imagining in the past, internationally, imagine how many memoirs have been written worldwide in the past 50 years. I was looking through it, and they chose only 50. And Amos Oz's A Tale of Love and Darkness was among them, which I was very pleased. Because, you know, first of all, I go to see, you know, what I am looking for. And I was very pleased to see it and look, maybe one of the first. So let me introduce to you the two writers. Aharon Appelfeld. He was born in 1932. He was born in what was Romania then. He was born in Chernovitz. Today it's called Chernivtsi, and it's in the Ukraine. He came to Mandatory Palestine at the age of 14. It wasn't Israel yet. I know that, you know, you'll know my age if I tell you. I always write, when they ask me, I write, I was born in Israel, but that's a lie. I was telling my husband just recently, we are lying on all the documents. We were born in Mandatory Palestine, in Palestine under the British. So he came to Israel at the age of 14. I'll tell you a little bit about what happened to him in the meantime. And Amos Oz, or in Hebrew, Amos Oz, was born in 39. Now, the year 2018 in Israeli culture was really bookmarked by the passing of these two giants of Hebrew literature. Appelfeld died in January and Amos Oz died in December. There was a 7-year difference between them, but in terms of Israeli literary history, and in terms of Israeli history, they belong to the same generation. In other words, there was a major war in 1948, after which the state of Israel, or a little bit before the war broke out, the state of Israel was established. They were too young to fight in the war, but they were old enough to understand the meaning of the birth of a state, the state of Israel. So they belong in many, many other ways to the same generation. And the year 2018, as I said, was bookmarked by the passing of these two writers. In the Hebrew calendar, they died in two different years. But I was thinking that maybe they wanted to send us a message. And the message, the symbolism about it is, we were so similar, and yet we were so different. Let me give you an outline. I'll talk about their similarities. I'll tell you about my personal encounters with them, because I have personal stories to tell you. I'll talk mainly about their differences. And in their differences, this is how I would break down the topics. I'll talk about their personal biographies that are very different. I'll talk about their different identity as Israelis. They identify themselves very differently as Israeli. Their very different attitude to the Hebrew language. They both wrote in the Hebrew language. Then I'll discuss their fictional landscape, the places where they write about, and the people that inhabit those landscapes. And then I'll focus on child figures also, because it is, both of them have child figures, and it is through the child figures that they start discussing or analyzing the questions of their identity. I will discuss their contributions to Israeli culture, not only Israeli literature, which is obvious, but culture, because each of them in his own way contributed to a major shift in Israeli culture, in, or what we call the national culture, psyche, in Israelis' attitudes to certain issues in Israeli life. I will also discuss their universal elements, why they became so famous universally. After all, one writes about the Holocaust and one writes about some godforsaken little terrain in the Middle East with its own local angst. How come they have been translated to 20 or 30 languages all over the world? I'll discuss then their universal elements, their identities as artists, which they both explain in their autobiographies, and then the conclusion. So let me talk a little bit about their similarities. Their similarities are very obvious. Both are Hebrew-Israeli writers. They lived in Israel and worked in Israel and first wrote in Hebrew. Now, Amos Oz was born in Jerusalem, so he is like the quintessential Israeli. Appelfeld came to Israel when he was 14. They both served in the Israeli military, and they both were called up many times through the years because God knows there were so many. I'm also Israeli born and a Sabra. God knows that there were so many wars after the 48 war, and in addition, all sorts of little military flare-ups and so on. If you follow the news, you know that there is a, you know, you just read the Jerusalem Post, there is a big war now down in Gaza, and you know, rockets are flying and missiles and so on. So both served in the Israeli military. Both studied at Hebrew University at a later age and majored in Judaic studies. I can tell you from my conversations with both, they have something else similar. I had an uncle who was professor of Jewish philosophy at Hebrew University, and they both studied with him. So this they have in common, Professor Ephraim Gottlieb, who unfortunately passed young. Both tie a certain personal trauma with a momentous event in Jewish history. And this is very interesting, because unfortunately what they also have in common is the traumatic loss of a mother at a very young age. Appelfeld was about 10 in Chernovitz when there was, like, the Nazis had a raid and they killed his mother and his grandma in front of the house. After that, he was taken to a labor camp with his father. He ran away from the labor camp, and he spent the rest of World War II in the European hinterland. He was not in any camp. And then after the war, all the young people were gathered together and sent to Israel. So he was a very blonde and Slavic looking, so he could disguise his identity. And when they found out, let's say he stayed for a while in a certain with a certain peasant's household. When they found out that he's Jew, he is a Jew, he just ran away. So he spent the war years as a child, as an orphan and a fugitive. In this sense, and Amos Oz lost his mother to suicide. His mother committed suicide before his bar mitzvah, before he was 13. So there is a difference, you know, in the way you lost, he lost his mother, but both connect the loss of the mother to a certain momentous event. Now with Appelfeld, the loss of the mother is the beginning of the Holocaust, not only for the Jewish people, but for him, right? So it's a personal trauma, but it's also the beginning of the Holocaust. For Amos Oz, it's a little bit more intricate and more interesting. In his work, he associates the tortures away or journey that the Jewish community in Little Palestine was experiencing on the way to the declaration of the state, and then the first few years to his mother torture or to his mother tormented soul in Palestine. Because his mother never warmed up to the Zionist idea. She hated the Middle East. She hated the heat. She hated everything about it. She always dreamed about, she came from Poland. She dreamed about her years, you know, in Poland and how she recited all sorts of Polish poetry in school. She was the star of the school. And then suddenly she is a fugitive. She comes to a desert. Jerusalem at that time was no more than a desert, no more than, you know, a bunch of ruins. And she shared with her son, some of you may have seen the movie based on A Tale of Love and Darkness. So she shared with her son her feelings. She was also, there was also lack of kind of agreement or meeting of the mind between her and his father. She was a very poetic, dreamy woman, and the father was just a realist and a very mediocre man. So, and the child Amos, while he was patriotic and he was really filled with Zionist zeal and we live here and this is our land, he also sympathized with his mother who dreamt about other landscapes, who lived in a different world. So he does associate, and she committed suicide a few years after the birth of the state. So for him also, that great tragedy is connected somehow with the birth of the state. And indeed, what happened to Amos Oz is that as soon as his mother committed suicide, he changed his last name. He belonged to a very renowned family in Jerusalem. His father's uncle was a very famous professor of history. He wrote a book also about Jesus. His name was Joseph Klausner. And that was a very right-wing revisionist family. So he changed his name to Oz, like divorcing himself from his father, left the family and left Jerusalem, and became a member as a young person in a kibbutz that was labor oriented. So he like abandoned the family heritage, family politics, everything in the family and his father, like he dissociated himself from his father's name. So in this sense, they are both similar in the trauma, but they are different in what, in how they combine the trauma and the momentous event that they live through. But in both works, in the works of both of each writer, there is always the presence of a mother figure. There is always a child. That in Appelfeld, the child is a fugitive, the child is an orphan, and he has vague memories of some female figure. And in Amos Oz's works, he has children also, and there is always a treacherous mother. Sometimes she leaves with a British officer. Sometimes she leaves her son because she descends almost willfully into madness. But they both have figures of children that are orphans and a mother figure. And very, very interestingly, in each and every work that they have a mother and a son, they actually tell their own story, but about some other people in a veiled way, in a disguised way. And only later in their lives, and that's similar in them, when they finally write their own autobiography, they write of the real mother and how they really lost her. So every one of their novels is kind of a concentric circle coming closer and closer until you come to the center, which is how I lost my real mother. So all the children in their works are kind of alter egos. So it's very important. And as said, the children embody their own struggle with identity, which I'll explain soon, but also the children become the embodiment of the collective consciousness of the people. So, and both explore their identities as Israelis, as Jews, and also give a kind of a manifesto of their art, what their art consists of. I met them both, and I tell you how. I can't control myself, I'll tell you. I met Aharon Appelfeld, at Wesleyan. I taught a course at Wesleyan before his lecture, and the faculty was speaking in English, and I came over and started in Hebrew, so he was very happy. He was a very fragile-looking man, short, and you know, being a Sabra, no matter that he spoke Hebrew with me, immediately I identified him as a non-Sabra. You know, no matter, and later on, when I read his autobiography, he says that all of his life he unsuccessfully tried to shed the diaspora, the East European mannerism and look that he had, although he came at the age of 14, right? But he, and unsuccessful, he tells another story in his autobiography that when he was inducted into the Israeli army, he noticed how the Israeli doctors, the army, the military doctors are chuckling when they look at him. He's so afraid. He didn't grow because, you know, he wasn't nourished by a mother in a home. That they chuckled at this little guy with a curvature in his spine and almost blind wants to be an Israeli soldier. So it's very interesting that he understood. And one of the the differences between Appelfeld and Oz is that even though Appelfeld, immediately when he started to write in Israel, he was accepted like into the literary canon. The critics immediately understood that he's a great writer. And he wrote in Hebrew. Even though he had a stable career, a stable family, he wrote in Hebrew, he always felt not like an Israeli. He felt like a stranger in his own land. And when he wrote in Hebrew, he said, I write in Hebrew, but I feel that Hebrew is a stepmother to me. On another occasion, he said, Hebrew was to me a macho language because of the Israeli reality where you needed, you know, we cultivated a certain macho image. I'll talk a little bit differently later about it. So this was my personal encounter. And he called me later also. I couldn't arrange a lecture for him here for a number of reasons. But then with Amos Oz, we had a lifelong epistolary, in other words, a corresponding relationship. But more than that, I published an article about a novel of his that was translated at the beginning of his career, a perfect piece into English. He read it. You know, at that time, I think Any review, when you're a new writer, any review, you swallow it up and you look at it and you reread it. So later, of course, he I don't think he read everything that was written about him. So he wrote a letter to Midstream. I published it in Midstream, an airmail letter in Midstream. And he wrote me really beautifully how he thought that I really understood, or I was closest to the heart of the book, the way he understood it. I think what I saw in him is that a beginner, writer who suddenly becomes internationally known, and he marvels at how come my stories that have to do with the kibbutz, that have to do with so many of the Israeli realities, how come people, understand them? So he wrote the letter to Midstream and sent it to me. Now, these were the days, antediluvian days, before the computer and before scanning. So when he died, I went to my old documents and I found it, and finally I scanned it, and now I saved it, the letter. So we started a correspondence, and I brought him here. And at that time, I was really surprised. He spoke at the Sheraton in Greenwich. We had about 400 people from the community coming out without mailing, without anything. And he spoke beautifully. And the president of UConn at the time also came down. And then we corresponded through the years. So I talked a little bit about their similarities and also, but started to talk about their differences. And of course, their own biography is very different. Their autobiographies also would be different. What is different about their identity is, as I said before, Appelfeld always felt like a stranger in Israel, even though he was accepted. Amos Oz, on the other hand, was the quintessential Israeli, a sabra, an insider. So he always felt as part of the country. In the fictional landscapes, they are very, very different. Appelfeld writes about pre-Holocaust Europe, about self-hating Jews, self-denying Jews in Europe. In Israel, when he started to write, nobody was interested in Europe before the Holocaust. We were building a new country, a new kind of Jew, a new kind of ideology. So nobody was really interested. The scholars were, but not the reading public. The landscape you will have, and I'll give you one example out of many, you will have a resort place called Badenheim. There were a lot of bathing places that the rich favored in Europe. So one like Baden-Baden and Marienbad. So this is Badenheim. And we are in the summer of Badenheim. And there is a group of people who great connoisseurs of music and poetry, speaking Hochdeutsch, meaning German, very good German, that they come together, if they gather every year. They come from all over Austria and Central Europe to Badenheim. This year, it's 1939. And of course, if you know a little bit of history, you know what 1939 means. So they come to that bathing place, and things are not as usual. For instance, there are barbed wires. I mean, this is a vacation place, a very posh resort place. So they give all sorts of excuses why there are barbed wires there. And we, from our point of view, understand. And then there is an orchestra and a very famous European conductor who always comes. He's their favorite. He always comes. Now he was delayed in the train, and some police in some town wanted to see his documents and his orchestra. He comes late. Things are not as usual. But of course, this bunch of people who consider themselves Austrian, German-speaking, great lovers of, European music, Beethoven, Wagner, and so on, and great lovers of European poetry, they deny or they ignore what they see. Well, suddenly, there is a note that everyone has to go to the sanitation department to register. So no one, nobody goes to register. Well, only people who don't have documents, undocumented people have to go. Turns out that they all have to go. Those great German, Austrian, Central European, great art lovers and cultured people were not born here. And then they say, not only those who were not born here, those who were born in Poland, they all were born in Poland. That's not enough. Only those who are Jews. Lo and behold, as you understand, everyone is a Jew, a self-denying Jew. To the very last minute, they deny it, right? And then finally it dawns on them that they're not going home. They're not going to stay here and listen to music and all of that. And so there is a Shabbat, a Sabbath, and they are completely secular. They are not secular Jews. If you ask them, they wouldn't say that they are Jews, right? Then suddenly they feel like in the Sabbath, like it's a holy day. At the end of the day, the old rabbi from 60 years ago is wheeled in. He represents their Jewishness, and he makes the blessing of Havdalah. The blessing of Havdalah we do every end of the Sabbath to separate from the Sabbath to a weekday. But his Havdalah is different because he's separating them from the good old days to what they really are. At the end, they are Jews and they are fugitives and they are standing to wait for a cattle train to take them back, you know, to the concentration camp. But these Jews, until the very last minute, deny what they see. In Israel, in the 60s, the Israelis were not interested in those Jews. There was also a very denigrating attitude to, unfortunately, to the Holocaust victims that, you know, I never shared, but, you know, they went to cattle to slaughter, so we are different. So this is his landscape. And then you have a Viennese writer, someone like Stefan Zweig, who is, from the point of view of a child also, who has been touted as the great writer of our century, who really understands the German and Austrian character. Then suddenly there are reviews about him that his work is decadent and it's rotten. Why? Because he's a Jew. He denies it. He's more Austrian than any Austrian. He writes in the best possible German. Everyone thought he really captured our century. But now, so this is another story. And then many other stories where you are in a town, or another story, the retreat. The Jewish people, a bunch of Jewish people, establish a retreat. In that retreat, they are going to cure themselves. What are they going to cure themselves of? Of their Jewishness, right? This is his landscape. And by the way, every time, and of course he has all those Ukrainian farms and peasants that he ran around in some brothels, because as a child he spent some time in a brothel. So every picture, every town or every landscape from Europe is told or is described or is narrated as if under a fog. Why? Because he was a child when he saw all of that. So when he writes about those places, this is Europe, but it's kind of in a foggy way, as if his memory is blunted. Amos Oz's landscape is Israel, the Israel that I know. Even when it can be a kibbutz, it can be a village, even when he describes Jerusalem being mystical and mysterious, even then if you know Jerusalem, you know the streets and the people. There is a familiarity to what he writes. So they write, their landscapes are very different. So in terms of the child figures, as I started to discuss, I'll discuss it a little bit more. Appelfeld's children, you find them in a state of trauma. In his very first collection of stories, there is a child who knows that he has to run away. He doesn't know why. It's like an animal instinct for survival. And he knows that there is a terrible secret in him, some kind of contamination, some kind of a stain. He doesn't know what it is. We understand what it is. And then he sees across the lake fishermen. But he knows to beware of those, fishermen, because they are not going to catch fish. They are going to capture Jews. So he is on the run. Or the girl Kitty, who wakes up to a surrounding. She doesn't know where she is, but she doesn't know who she is. She doesn't remember what happened before that moment when she wakes up. There is a strange language that's being spoken, and all sorts of strange icons. We understand. I used to do that story with some of my classes, but if I did experimentally, sometimes I gave them an introduction before they read it. When I did not give them an introduction, they simply could not understand the story. She wakes up, she's probably one of those hidden children. She wakes up in a convent. She was probably put in a convent, placed in a convent for safety, but it was such a traumatic, parting from the parents that she forgot she had parents. She forgot where she came from. And now she sees all those icons and the nuns. And as she, and first they think that she's dumb or that she's an idiot because she doesn't talk. She lost language, which happened to a lot of children in that kind of trauma. So what happens, gradually she comes to understand on her own, because the nuns are very nice to her. They want to protect her. But on the other hand, she feels that they regard her as someone sinful, as someone who is carrying a sin in her, or some kind of poison, or some kind of contamination. As she becomes more and more aware, she becomes that sin or that taint that's inside her is dual. She comes to realize that she's a Jew, she's Jewish, and now she's learning to be a Christian, and she's learning all those Christian mythology and the icons. She also is becoming a woman. She's 12. So she's becoming a woman, and she knows that for the nuns, they rejected their femininity. So she understands that they are not going to even support her on that. That's the girl Kitty. And so many other children. There is a boy Lies. And I hope you'll go and read his stories, because then you see a boy who is suddenly finds himself in a caravan. He doesn't know why. Where, who put him there? Who are those people? It's a caravan of misfits. And that's how Appelfeld sees Jewish history. All sorts of misfits, just traveling and traveling, never getting anywhere. So this is the child, and this is the child figure in Appelfeld. In Amos Oz, on the contrary, there are many child figures. But the child is always a patriot. He knows who he is. I'll give you an example of a story that I'd like you to read. The story is about a panther in the basement. It's about a boy who is named Profi. His friends call him Profi because he's professor. But this is the time of the waning of the British mandate in Israel, 1947. Now, those of you who know Israeli history know that in November 29 of 1947, there was a very critical vote in Lake Success in the UN, which was then in Lake Success, for the partition of the land, right, between the Jews and the Arabs. And actually, the partition was, Amos also reminds us, into three parts. And you know what the third part was? For a land for the Jews, a land for the Arabs, and Jerusalem. Jerusalem would be an international place, city, and the Jews accepted it, and the Arabs did not accept it. So these are the days of the waning of the British mandate, and there is a bunch of kids, a group of kids playing in the summer. There is no JCC, no summer camp, no anything. So they are left to their own devices. And these kids fancy themselves to be part of the Haganah, of the underground. They really run around with documents. Sometimes people from the underground give them letters. They amass all sorts of weapons, or so they think, bullets and so on. And they model themselves after King David, because the Bible is the Jewish epic, Jewish national epic, and King David is the most heroic character because he is the one who broadened the land and left a very good country, peaceful country, to his son Solomon. So they fancy themselves part of the, you know, a cell of the underground, and they model themselves after King David. However, this boy, Profi, who is a little bit more intellectual than the other kids, and that's why they call him Professor, although in English it works better, you'll see why. At night, there is a blackout, and he has to go home, and he's afraid. He overstayed. So a British officer picks him up and brings him home. And suddenly he realizes this British officer is not the enemy. He's a middle-aged man. He has asthma. He breathes very with difficulties. So, and they make an arrangement that a Profi will teach him Hebrew, because that British officer speaks Hebrew, but biblical Hebrew, and sounds very funny, as if I started to talk in Shakespearean English today, right? It's very funny. It's like modern Hebrew, but it's different. So Profi will teach him Hebrew, and he will teach him, the officer will teach him English. Now, one day, Profi gets up in the morning, and there is a poster under his door. Profi is a traitor. Why? Because the kids found out that he is a friend of the enemy, right? It's 1947, and the British haven't left yet. So Profi, and they call him to a military tribunal because they have their own group and so on. As Profi, you know, he's very upset about it. Imagine, it's like bullying. Your friends tell you you're a traitor in a time when you have to really be very patriotic, you know, a Zionist. And he suddenly thinks, and he says to himself, and the prophet Jeremiah in the Bible was also called a traitor. Because just very briefly, I can't tell you the whole story, but when Jerusalem was under siege by the Babylonians in the 6th century before the Common Era, the prophet Jeremiah told the people of Jerusalem, open the gates of Jerusalem and let them in, right? Because he knew we are doomed anyway. However, the people of Jerusalem thought they would be able to withstand the siege. So suddenly, this prophet, whose model was the heroic King David, is suddenly called a traitor. And as a matter of fact, here we see that Profi is Amos' alter ego, because Amos says, they have called me a traitor many times in my life. I'll explain to you why in a second. But that Profi suddenly sees that there is a different option. Not that he's saying, let's give up being a state, but he sees a different model, maybe a more peaceful, a more conciliatory way of dealing with the Arabs. As you know, it's very easy to pigeonhole these two writers, to say that Appelfeld is a Holocaust writer and Amos Oz is a Peace Now writer, because he was one of the founders of the Peace Now movement. The Peace Now was a movement that said, land for peace. They thought if we give a little bit more land, if you don't build settlements, the Arabs will finally accept us. And that culminated later in the famous Oslo Accord and the two-state solution. I can't talk about that right now. But anyway, some people said, well, Amos Oz is a Peace Now writer, and that's not true. Appelfeld didn't write about the death camps because he wasn't there. You don't have gas chambers. You don't have people killed because he wasn't there. He writes about the crisis of identity of diaspora Jews before the Holocaust and their self-denial and denial. And on the other hand, Amos Oz is not just a political writer. You can't say that his stories are just political allegories or political manifestos. He really transcends his politics. Both of them transcend the little pigeonhole in which they sometimes were put in. So when you speak about Appelfeld, although his children, his child figures, are so different from Appelfeld's child figures because they are so certain, they have an inner court of certainty. We were born here. This country belongs to us. Amos Oz himself suddenly sees two options to our identity here. And in other stories, for instance, there is the boy Hillel, whose mother at the end runs away with a British officer. But while he is, again, very patriotic, he writes a letter to the British high officer in Jerusalem, to the British governor, telling him, you get out of here, you British. This land belongs to us. And later on, if you read his novel, his autobiography, A Tale of Love and Darkness, it's Amos Oz himself who writes no more and no less to King George. And he says to him, get out of this country. It belongs to us. So the child is very patriotic. However, he also understands his mother. He understands her, and in fact, both Appelfeld and Oz attribute their abilities as artists, as fiction writers, as sensitive people to their mothers, to their mother's sensitivity and like more poetic and dreamy personality. So in this respect, and also with regard to the Hebrew language, I told you what Appelfeld thought of the Hebrew language, and he never felt close, although he writes beautiful Hebrew. But Amos Oz, this is his language. This is the reservoir of his networks, of associations. So there are many differences between them in terms of how they identify themselves and in terms of their landscapes. I didn't talk about their contributions to the national psyche. Appelfeld is partially responsible for assimilating the Holocaust experience of the Jews in Europe to the Israeli identity. Because the Israelis grew up at that time, and Amos Oz writes about it, as new Jews. And I remember myself, and I grew up in an Orthodox family, so we had Jewish roots. We are not Jews. We are Israelis, and the Israelis are a different breed of people. We are not like them. We will not be led like cattle to slaughter. If we die, we die on our sword. We die in pride. We die protecting our country. So in Appelfeld's works and his presence contributed to a real shift in Israeli attitudes towards the Holocaust. Today, the Holocaust is not only something that happened to the Jews over there in history, it's part of our identity. And Appelfeld tells us a story that much later in his life, in 73, when there was the Yom Kippur War, and he was sent already as an education officer to the Suez Canal, he felt very estranged from the younger soldiers. They suddenly were attracted to him. They came over to him and they started to ask him about, you know, the Jews of pre-Holocaust Europe. And suddenly they realized and they let him know that, you know, we feel that our predicament as Israelis is part not only of the Israeli experience, it's part of the Jewish experience. So he contributed in a major way to that assimilation of the Holocaust victim identity into the Israeli identity. With Amos Oz, he gave voice to a more sober attitude to Zionism. Not that he was a Zionist. There are contemporary writers in Israel who say we are post-Zionist, we are post-modern. No, he is a Zionist. But after the euphoria of the 48 war and the victory and the admiration of the world, the grayness of life set in and a more sober attitude was needed. And he embodied it. He told Israelis, a lot of our problems were not solved. We are still under a state of siege. There is a moral and ethical question with regard to the Palestinians. There is what I called in my courses the tragedy of a dual claim to the same land. And we are human beings. And as human beings, we have all sorts of problems that are stamped with our local, you know, surroundings, a local situation. But we are also human beings. So there is a lot of universal elements in him also. The single woman, the generational conflict, the son who doesn't rise up to his father's, expectations. And what Amos was saying was, there was a generation of giants, and they were filled with Zionist zeal. But you can all not all, you know, continue living in euphoria, in utopia. Israel is a state with its own problems, and let's just get used to the normalcy of life. Well, he embodied that. But he wrote about mainly the human condition. I think this is why he's so accepted universally. You have the inventor who left his family, abandoned his family because he was going to be a great architect or great engineer and draw all or build all those great bridges all over the world. He ends up in Jerusalem all alone. Yeah, he abandoned his family. He did not realize his expectations of himself and ends up in Jerusalem alone and so forth. So he has a master spy who has solved so many espionage problems and riddles. He cannot solve the problem of why his wife died an untimely death. Was it an accident? Was it a suicide? What was the neighbor doing there? So he solved so many problems that he can't solve his own private problems. So there are many universal elements. They contributed to Israeli psyche, to changes in Israeli psyche. At the same time, they are universal. And in their autobiographies, they discuss why they are artists. They both understand that their works are steeped in history. And Amos Oz tells stories from Jerusalem history that I know about. I'll tell you just one story. There was a very infamous incident when a group of professors and doctors went in a caravan, and they were supposed to Mount Scopus because the Hebrew University and the Hadassah Hospital was there, and the British soldiers were supposed to protect them. They were attacked by the Arabs. There was a big massacre, and the British set aside and didn't do anything. And my husband himself was a little boy. He stood in the terrace and he saw the flames. About 80 professors and doctors died at that time. So when he tells the story, he tells the story in a journalistic, unadorned way. But he says that he was a child historian, and yet he chose to narrate things not historically with accuracy, but to narrate them with the help of the imagination. And Appelfeld said the same. So that he knows that he writes about history, but he can write about history only as an artist to add the imagination. And I'll read to you perhaps just what I thought as conclusion. So they both are very much steeped in the moment of history that they belong to and how it relates to Jewish past, yet consciously they decided to choose the imaginative narrative. They are to be writers of fiction rather than historians. They write history, but with the help of the imagination. And in terms of their national identity, they're really very different from current writers, because they both both define themselves within a broader the broader parameter of Jewishness, Jewish history, and Zionism. Both declare themselves to be Zionists and to be Jews. Thank you. Good. And we'll 10 minutes to questions and answers. Okay, yes. Dr. Freiberg is saying, basically he's telling us, he was reminding us of the Mufti. The Mufti was the head of the Muslim community, and he basically said, we will turn Israel into a ghetto. So he himself connected what was happening, you know, during the War of Independence to the Jewish experience in diaspora, and that's very true, right? So if we wanted to be estranged, the Muslims or the outside world didn't want to recognize us as new Jews. Any more questions? Yes. Whether, you know, there is now, today especially, the question is raging whether Israel is a Jewish state or a state for the Jews. It's, they do not address it directly. I think that Amos Oz was very conflicted about, you know, what's happening in Israel. The two-state solution is dead now, right? And it's for him it was tragic. Appelfeld did not relate to the Arab or Palestinian problem at all. He related to the fact that Israel is a Jewish state, but he described Judaism in a much broader sense as a kind of a, not a political entity, but in the form of what Martin Buber thought about Judaism as a universal spiritual entity. I would say this is the difference. I didn't have the time to talk about Amos Oz's very last novel, Judas, where he discusses that conflict, that political conflict in himself, maybe at another time. Okay, thank you.
We would be pleased to send a complimentary DVD of this program to anyone who wishes to support JBS with a tax-deductible gift of $36, double chai, or more. And we're especially pleased to remind you that thanks to a generous matching gift from the Cayley family, every new or increased dollar you donate to JBS will be worth double to JBS. Simply visit the JBS website at jbstv.org and click on the Donate button to make a donation by PayPal or your credit card. And please, indicate the program for which you would like a DVD. Or you can send your tax-deductible check to JBS, P.O. Box 180, Riverdale Station, Bronx, New York, 10471. And again, please remember to indicate which program you would like to receive with our compliments. And we thank you for your kind support.